The process of this movie coming out has started at, I guess, Telluride, yeah?
I haven't had, I actually haven't been talking about it too much because I've been in Australia, so oh. I haven't been...
Working on the next thing?
Or? Yeah, working on the next thing.
Okay. So that's exciting. That's it keeps you distracted from all the insanity that part of it is.
Yeah, it's nice.
The releasing part, I mean, because it's interesting, your movies have kind of... gone, each of them has kind of come from a different direction in terms of how the industry works.
Sure.
Is this easier to have a whole studio machine pushing it out, or is it less work? Is it more work? Is it?
I mean, this particular movie, I think I've been able to lean a bit more on Michael B. Jordan and Jamie Foxx and Brie and Bryan Stevenson to. Primarily because it is so much Bryan Stevenson's story.
Mm-hmm.
I've been able to watch I mean really enjoy watching them talk about it and hear their perspective on it through the media.
So you haven't had to carry that particular. You've been free to go to work.
Yeah, a little bit more. A little more.
So what got you into this one in particular? What was the? How did you first hear about it? And
the book, Bryan Stevenson's book, Just Mercy, I read it. It was given to me by our producer, Gil Netter, and it just blew me away. It was a really moving, powerful read that introduced me to these characters that I wasn't expecting to relate to as much as I did. And I, by the end of it, I was laughing and in tears and just so inspired and wanting to be involved in any way I could.
Mm. So did you dive right into, was there a script at that point or was it just
No script. We started off, I mean, the first thing I had to do was meet with Bryan Stevenson, who is, it kind of feels like meeting the Dalai Lama, like the amount of goodness he has brought into this world over the course of his time here is so intimidating that meeting him is, but I met him and he had seen Short Term 12 and really connected with the way that those characters were treated that he felt that I could be the person to help tell this story.
And so, going back to Short Term 12 and Glass House, and you know, there's a sense that you are a master of this kind of area of people who are the underprivileged, I guess, of the world, who are trying to find their ways in different and through different routes. Is that something that you're particularly interested in as a filmmaker, or is it something that has kind of become a signature for you, or what do you think?
I'm always, for whatever reason, I'm always drawn to characters who are outsiders. And I know for myself that what that feels like, to feel like an outsider, even in a room full of people laughing and having a great time and feeling like you're not a part of any of it. And I gravitate towards stories where I can give a little bit of hope to other people who feel like that. I do think especially when I started in this industry, it was an extremely scary thing for me. There's a lot of big voices and a lot of loud voices and a lot of big opinions and a lot of people telling you, oh, if you're going to make it in this industry, you have to do this, 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 this. You have to go to a party. You have to know who to network with. You have to talk to the right people. And all of that just made me feel like I wanted to die. It was just so uncomfortable. But there was there's a time in my early career when I wasn't making any money when I just had to decide, I'm not going to survive unless I just allow myself to be myself, who is a bit more soft-spoken. I'm not the best pitcher. I hate networking. If I go to a party, I'll be the one standing in the corner. But I started to find out that there's other people standing in the corner. and they happen to, a lot of times, they're very talented and just are not into the fluffy stuff as much. And so that's kind of who I've ended up gravitating towards. All to say, I feel like that feeling just gets me to gravitate towards those types of characters and stories. And I've always felt that, at least for me, growing up on an island in the middle of the Pacific, going to the movies helped me to feel less alone in the world. And if I can tell a movie where one person can watch it and be like, oh, there's other people going through something like that I thought I was the only one, but someone else is going through it, so maybe I'm okay. That's mm-hmm. what I hope to
so make. Was your crew, when you build a crew and a lot of people, you have a lot of people who are very loyal to you in the industry, who have worked with you before, is that a safer space? Is it a different social experience for you, or are you feeling similarly shy amongst your own gathered posse?
I'm definitely not. My posse is my safe space, and my friend, I work with the same people a lot because I feel so safe around them. They happen to be very good at what they do, thank goodness. But for me, it's such a crazy emotional roller coaster. Every movie, you just go through so many ups and downs that to have people that I trust and who know my insecurities, who understand every part of me and have been through it before, that helps me, really helps me to stay grounded and not go off the rails.
Well, is that, do you have that, is that in your nature?
My off the rails is like just in my head. I don't
just keep you calm.
Yeah. My going off the rails is comes out in just nerves or just getting really quiet and not just spinning out in my head.
So how planned are is the work on your set? I mean, you, one of the things about your films is you get the feeling of not necessarily improv, but you get a certain feeling of looseness and a feeling that there's, you know, that the actors and the characters have rooms to breathe in a way that you don't see in a lot of films, particularly studio films. Is that how you shoot, or is it, do you know exactly what you want and you're kind of waiting for people to get there, or how do you operate?
All of our movies are planned as much as we are allowed to plan with the time. I would prefer to plan everything. So even Short-Term 12, we had a lot of time before we started shooting. So it has a very loose quality to it, but every shot in there was shot listed and actually storyboarded. We went to the sets with my DP and with Brett and I, and we went with a camera like this sometimes, mm-hmm. or just a still camera, and we got every shot that we're going to do. But then the hope is, while we're on set, we have our backup plan. The mm-hmm. pre-plan is the backup plan, and we hope that it's elevated through what's naturally happening there, and whatever the actors are doing. And we try to keep it as loose as possible while we're on set.
Are the actors more like, on your set, are they more like your relationship with the crew than like the actors who are over there in the trailer and the, you know what I mean? Is it a bit more intimate than
it depends,
you might see?
Yeah, it depends on the actor. But I think most of our, yeah, I actually haven't experienced really the diva actor who just doesn't want to jump in with the vibe that we create. And you really are going through some of the most intense emotional experiences with this group of people, with a lot of pressure that you're either going to start yelling at each other or laugh together because you're so stressed out. And I prefer laughing. And so I think most actors, or every actor that I've worked with, you know, there's always a testing period in the beginning, but over the course of the movie, we all start to realize that we're all in it together, and everybody starts having a fairly good time despite how stressful things can get.
And one of the things in Just Mercy is that you have a lot of solo moments in the picture, because you have a bunch of, you know, there are a lot of the actors and the characters are in cages.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, and Michael actually has more of an thing of, you know, having people around him and things like that. And then Jamie's basically in a box for 80% of his performance. Is that harder? Is it more, is it easier in some ways because it's so concentrated and focused, and you know?
What was difficult? I mean, it ended up not being difficult, but was difficult to imagine before we started shooting was a big part of this movie is about the camaraderie between the prisoners on death row. Which is something, when I was prepping, I spoke with Anthony Ray Hinton, who was played by he's played by O'Shea Jackson in the movie, and he was on death row at the time of Walter McMillan, in the late 80s, and he was on death row for 30 years for a crime he didn't commit, and he was explaining to us that while he was on the row, he would have friendships with people that he didn't even know what the color of their skin was because he never met them in person, but they would sometimes be shouting conversations to each other from upstairs to downstairs, and there were all these conversations happening. And a big part of it was that camaraderie that was built between people who were otherwise completely isolated. So to capture that was we weren't sure how we were going to be able to capture that, and what we decided to do was to put our three friends whose cells share walls with each other, and it's Anthony Ray Hinton, played by O'Shea Jackson, Walter McMillan, played by Jamie Foxx, and then Herbert Richardson, played by Rob Morgan. And we just shot them all with three cameras simultaneously and put them in cells next to each other. So, and then we had the script, and they would do the lines of the scene, and then they would improvise, sometimes for 5 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes. They would just go off. And then at some point, one of the three of them would say the first line of the scene again, and then they'd go through the scene in maybe a little looser way. And we just ran it like that for a while and captured a lot of little moments that that are kind of impossible to script. But it surprisingly felt a lot like people were just having a conversation, but you almost forget that there's a wall in between each of them.
That sounds like a second film. Or like an added feature,
DVD,
second DVD. Because it must have been fascinating just to listen to that footage. I mean, it must have been like a kind of a natural rhythm that developed that felt very, that must have been very intimate and interesting to see.
Those three are quite a trio together when they start improvising. It's fun to watch.
So when that's happening, where are you? Are you in a video village watching all three cameras? Or are you?
It really just feels like I'm just watching the movie and just looking,
right.
Making cuts just wherever I look.
So you have, there each one is individual to the cell. There's no camera from the outside really, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, it was a set that we built on a stage because we wouldn't gain access to a home in prison.
Yeah.
So Sharon Seymour, our production designer, she figured out the exact design of that death row.
So it's specific to that prison.
Yeah, it's specific to that prison. Everything, even the execution chamber, is the exact square footage of that execution chamber, and the exact replica of the chair.
And of course, the British villain from the Deep South.
Yeah.
Is that? I mean, he's a great actor, Rafe Spall. But yeah. Is it weird to bring in a guy who, you know, when you say cut, starts speaking with a British accent when you're?
He actually flew in from London and came straight to set, and had to be on camera, like, without sleeping for, I think he said, 48 hours.
Huh.
And he went straight into a courtroom scene where he was speaking with a pretty flawless Southern accent, and Jamie Foxx was sitting there and heard, after I yelled cut, he heard him just switch to British and say, so how was that in his British accent? And Jamie just flipped out. It's like, who is this guy? but Rafe actually, he said when he showed up to Alabama, he would just stay in character and go out to dinner just to practice his Southern accent, and he would go to dinner as that character by himself and see if anybody was knowing that he was doing it, but that's how he practiced.
I'm sure sweet tea sounds different in a Southern accent.
Yeah, it all.
And so the Jamie relationship, I mean, Jamie obviously puts himself out in this movie in a way we haven't really seen in other pictures. And he's very not funny in this movie. Was that a conversation, or did he just say, did he come into this conversation saying, I'm not going to crack a smile, or I'm not going to tell it, I'm not going to do anything remotely adorable in the process of doing this? Or what was that conversation?
There wasn't that conversation. I mean, I do. He, when I first talked to Jamie, he just said, "I know this guy." Mm. Like, he grew up in the South in Texas, and he personally understands the struggle that Walter McMillan went through, and he shared a lot of personal things with me that really. That really felt like he was the perfect person to represent Walter McMillan. And
it's almost like he dropped his toolkit. It's like Jamie has, even when he was doing stand-up, but then, through the movies and everything, they're definitely like Jamie Foxisms in all of his work, except for this movie. He just, like, he threw them away and gave you something else, which is kind of fascinating.
It was fascinating to watch, for sure. He definitely didn't drop the Jamie Foxx act on set. He was like, he was doing stand-up bits. He's an actor that never went to his trailer. I don't think he ever went to his trailer. In between, even if we had an hour or two to set up, he would be doing. You just hear people laughing or dancing, and it's because he's got his boombox going, and he's just. It was a joy to have him there. He kept morale up all the time. I mean, even those courtroom scenes take forever to shoot. And if you watch Jamie Foxx, he just sits there for the entire courtroom scene. But he was completely in character every time we were shooting. And as soon as we yell cut, he's turning around and doing stand-up to the whole, to all the extras there. And everyone was loving him. But... I do think that this character is just really close and special to him. He has a very, very personal connection to the South, and wanted to make sure that Walter McMillan didn't come across as a cliche, that he came across as somebody that anybody can relate to. And I do think he played him with just enough charm and intellect that you can see the Walter McMillan that we kind of got to know through the videos and documentaries that we had of him, and the way that Bryan Stevenson describes him in his book.
So one of the things about the picture that struck me was the scale of it. This is your first studio movie, yes?
Yeah, pretty much. Lionsgate, I guess, is kind of a studio.
Well, major studio.
Yeah.
Officially. And was Lionsgate on that from the beginning, or was that a pickup for them?
They were on that from the beginning.
So your first bigger studio.
Sure.
But it was interesting because I went back actually and looked at Glass House and noticed that some of the, like, particularly some of the landscapes and things were things that were in there as well.
Mm-hmm.
You had not skimped on that because you were making a slightly lower budget film. Were there benefits to being with a bigger studio? In terms of production, did it change how you made the movie at all? Or is that, it just a coincidence that you had more trailers or whatever? a few more bucks for craft service.
To me, working with Warner Brothers was, had immense benefits in every direction. We just had a really great support system of people who were very invested in this project. And I think that's all you can ask for is people who believe in the story and want to do whatever it takes to get it made. That doesn't mean they're just constantly throwing money at us by any means. It's still a fairly lower budget thing for them, but we felt fully supported by them because they were, all of our executives, both our core executives who were with us day to day and people on top were so passionate about this story. We felt very, very supported all across the board. It allowed us to build sets like we were, we actually shot at Tyler Perry Studios for a lot of the interior. That's where we built our set for Death Row.
Mm-hmm.
But then we also built, we also went to some actual prisons around Atlanta. And we were really happy to also be able to shoot in Montgomery, Alabama, where we got a lot of our exteriors and Michael B. Jordan running.
the Tom Cruise shot.
Yeah.
You've got to get in. So Michael is really, this is one of his, I guess, Creed, certainly he was the lead and the star and whatever, but this is like a movie star role in a lot of ways. It's very, he's the driving, dogmatic, clear lead in this kind of picture. Is that, which isn't really what you've done before, historically, is that an interesting structure to deal with in terms of filmmaking for you?
I've never done a movie like this before where you're, it was fun to go and watch. There's such a rich history of law, lawyer, courtroom dramas, even more recent movies like Spotlight that are about just good people trying to do their work and do something positive. It was fun to kind of dive into all of that and see what would work, what wouldn't work for us, and how it could pertain to telling this story.
Are there movies that were keystones for you, or?
There were elements from, we learned a lot from watching the Verdict, from watching Philadelphia, learned a lot from watching. Spotlight's one of my favorite movies of the past 5 years, and I just love kind of the simplicity of that story. But we also learned a lot from movies I won't say that we did not want to do. It was all very informative. I think our for this movie, our secret weapon was that we had just a personal connection with arguably one of the greatest lawyers in our country right now. Bryan Stevenson was we just had his ear for any time we had questions about the process of law or what they would be doing in the office at this point. And so we were able to get all that stuff fairly accurate.
So did Michael dive into that opportunity, or did he avoid it a little bit to keep his own character going?
He did. I went with Michael B. out to Montgomery before we started shooting, and he spent time with Bryan Stevenson and gave him the tour of the place, and then Michael B. got to spend some time with him just to ask him specific lawyer questions, like, and also he was. It's fun watching actors do whatever they do, because he was just noticing how Brian drinks his tea. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's one of the little things, like Brian drinks tea, doesn't drink coffee. He also never hasn't taken a sip of alcohol since he was like a kid. Never in his life. And so Michael B. was watching how he would drink his tea and what he little things that he was doing with his hands. Does he fiddle with his pen? So he was picking up a lot of these little things when we were there. And he was also Michael B. was very interested in the courtroom, as you know, Michael comes from sports, and he sees the courtroom as a playing field. And so he was, and Bryan Stevenson actually grew up playing basketball, so they had a lot of interesting discussions of like how the strategy of the courtroom, where you stand in position to your client. And there is one moment in the movie where Brian literally like just puts himself in between the person who's on the stand and the person who is intimidating him from the bench, and just cuts off that eye line, which was something that Brian told us is something that he would do. And learning all that kind of strategy and positioning was something that Michael B. was really interested in.
When you guys did a subtle version of the hero lawyer performance, I mean, he has a couple speeches, but it mostly seems to be a character who is kind of holding his water and not wanting to, you know, not doing the showy stuff that you would necessarily expect.
It's that is a result of the specific story that we're telling, which is a young black lawyer in the South who is arguing to people who are by default not wanting to listen to anything he's saying. So that was Brian was repeatedly reminding us that he would always have to remember who he's talking to and what the repercussions of his emotions are. If he's speaking to a sheriff or a judge and he loses himself, mm-hmm. or speaks condescendingly or calls somebody out, that one is just not going to get what he wants, and it's going to shut them down. But it also has a trickle effect where it can get back to his clients, who these people have power over. So he said he was constantly having to restrain his emotions, which was I found it to be a really mature way for the way that Michael B. interpreted that, what I thought was a really cool, mature performance.
And of course, Tim Blake Nelson comes in and steals his scenes, as he tends to do with these things. And is that performance based on the act? Because we do see the actual guy in the end in footage or whatever.
A little,
is it based on his quirks? Or was that stuff just Tim brought to the table? And
no, Tim studied, there's a 60 Minutes piece that anyone could see on it's on YouTube. And Tim studied Ralph Myers through that piece and really got him down to a T like that. He was doing that lip thing. The first, after it was, I talked to Tim on the phone, and then I think like it was like a month later, he sent me like a video, and he said, "I've been practicing the lip thing. I think I got it down." And so he did all of that just by. But that is a result of the burns that Ralph Myers had, and Tim's an amazing actor. He's super fun to work with.
I always think that there's going to be like a moment where people, overall, besides people in the industry, realize how really effete Tim is. I mean, he is such a thinker and such a reader and such a so knowledgeable about so many things. And, you know, he's always playing these morons. And it's like, it's so not him. He's also not the evil vice president, but it's like opposite.
Yeah. So
which
true.
I guess is why he plays him so well.
So true.
He's figured it out. And Brie, you know, she's featured in the ads because she's the only girl, really, in the movie, practically, except for the family. It's really a kind of a somewhat thankless role.
Yeah.
I mean, she has a couple moments, but she basically, she's, you know, serving the movie.
Yeah.
And she has that crazy wig, which, again, we see in the end of the movie that it's what the woman actually looked like. But it's like, wow. But she just, where are we going, Destin? Let's get on it. Is that where it goes, or?
No, I mean, for Brie, she read the book and was just really passionate about telling this story and wanted to be of service. She did really see this as a supporting role and embraced that. I think.
But it wasn't like she could show up for a week, and she was there for most of the time, it seems like.
She was
there. Or a lot of the time.
Yeah, she was there for like half of our shooting time. And I think a lot of what Brie contributes to any movie, and particularly this one, are things that, yes, are thankless and things that you would never see, because like Jamie, is not the type of actor who just goes back to her trailer. She really helps to create an atmosphere of play and sensitivity, and she was a huge participant in a lot of these off-camera discussions that people were having about, you know, it was such a diverse crew, and everybody had their own personal stories that were connected to the subject matter, and so many times you'd see Brie and Jamie Foxx and Michael B and a bunch of crew members who were just talking through stories of family members who are incarcerated, or it became somewhat of like a really healing therapeutic sessions that were happening. When Brie stepped on set, it changes things. It just like there's she kind of has like a no bullshit meter that I love, that I think allows just people to be their best selves, and for people who are maybe like in the corner, like the PAs or the interns who might have a softer voice, like I feel like she has a tendency to look out for those people, which I think raises everybody up on set, and I really do think that that's what you end up seeing on screen.
So you talk about the diversity of your crew, circumstantial or intentional?
Intentional. Yeah, it really has to be intentional. You Right now, I mean, our movie was the first movie that Warner Brothers did that used the inclusion rider, and so it was official from the top down that we create as diverse a crew as possible. What that allowed us to do was to put people in positions that they'd never been able to step into before. So we had a couple of key department heads who had never been a department head before, but they've been working in the industry for 30, 40 years. And so we were giving them kind of the first chance to just like be the head of their department. And it was such a natural thing for them to step into. They were so good at their jobs. They just, for whatever reason, hadn't had that opportunity. And it was, yeah, it definitely never felt like we were making a hire just to be diverse. We were making kind of the obvious hires. And a lot of times we were allowed to give people an opportunity that they hadn't had up until that point. But I know from this point on they will be able to do that with any movie that they step into.
I find that fascinating. I mean, because I think it's such an issue, and I think that a lot of the conversations about how many female directors or about, you know, how many movies about women, things like that, or people, minorities, people of color, but it's the infrastructure of making movies, to me, is so much what it's really about, and it's all those people in the, you know, whose names you don't know, and their ability to grow, and then they, of course, you know, they go to the next thing, having, you know, first ADs who were of color and, mm-hmm. and female and things like that were just not happening. Mm-hmm. And I feel like if the industry is seated a little bit, mm-hmm. that they'll just naturally take over, because I don't really think people are that, I'm sure there are some racists out there, but it's not really, the people are not really racist, I don't think, in the industry. They're just used to something else.
Totally.
And it's their friends who happen to be white and male, and that's what it's been for a long time. And
It's like
it's encouraging.
It's friends and it's the resumes. Like you can't. I mean, if you're not going to give somebody an opportunity, you have to kind of look at the resume and see. Yes, they haven't done this, but oh my gosh, they've done this for that many years. So of course they can do this. They just haven't had the friend who's just going to be like, go for it. And so I do, it's exciting. I think it's exciting to be able to do that in a movie and know that it's going to have a ripple effect afterwards.
I always remember when I was a kid, I worked at Saturday Night Live when I was 21 years old, 20 years old, whatever it was. And Lorne Michaels came back to the show. He had left for a few years and was coming back. And the Saturday Night Live wasn't making money at the time, and they were talking about canceling it, putting in wrestling full-time on Saturday night. And when he was coming back, the company, NBC, had decided only Lorne Michaels or the guys who did Fridays, John Moffat and Lee, they were the only two people that were options even to come back and produce the show. I mean, they would not consider anybody else, even though there are obviously a lot of talented people and a lot of people have done comedy shows. But they had not done that kind of show. So therefore, the only people they were going to trust were that. And it was like, wow. That tells us exactly. I mean, it's worked out okay at SNL, but it's shocking to me. Yeah. That, you know, and I do think that's how people, how the people with the money, ultimately, the deciders, think about it a lot of the time.
Yeah.
And a little opportunity goes a long way.
Yeah, it does.
So are you finished with your next project? I mean, in terms of the production, or are you still in the middle of it?
We're still in prep. Yeah.
Oh, it's still in prep. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So is it good? I mean, we started the conversation where I was saying that, you know, you don't have to pay attention to all this publicity, but is it good to be working on something else and not thinking about what the process of getting to opening day is on a picture like this?
I have a family, so it's always better to be working, I think, for me.
So are you very interested in all this stuff? Are you looking at, you know, are you really obsessed with what the trailer or the ads or the cutdowns look like, or are you kind of let the pros do their work?
Yeah, I I want people to see this movie, and you know, more so, this movie is so much more than entertainment to me. I'm so passionate about Bryan Stevenson's work. The movie takes place in the late 80s, early 90s, at the beginning of the work that he's doing, but he and his team at the Equal Justice Initiative in Montgomery are doing some of the most exciting civil rights, social justice, law work in our country right now. And they are just as active as they were at the time of our movie. So I really hope that this movie can get out there as much as possible for people to be introduced to Bryan Stevenson and hopefully participate in some way.
And do you feel hopeful? I mean, your films are, there's always a social underpinning, as I was saying before. Do you feel like we're at a good point in terms of making progress, or are we still kind of slogging through the mud, or
both? We're definitely at a point where the scales could tip one way or the other, and there's definitely been some backpedaling happening. I mean, Bryan Stevenson, they do a lot of their work is arguing to the Supreme Court, and some of the recent changes were huge deals to them, and the work that they're doing.
Like the Voting Rights Act, or?
I'm sorry?
Like their idea that there was no racism in the South anymore? Or?
Well, sure.
That's a few years old now. Don't need Voting Rights Act. Sorry. Everything's okay.
But I do think that there's a growing awareness and hunger among people and in our country and who just want to help and they don't really exactly know how. I think it's so easy right now with the amount of negativity that's flooded into our phones and TV every day, it can feel pretty paralyzing and overwhelming, the amount of things that feel like are out of control or wrong in the world, that it's hard to even think of where to start. But that's one of the things about this book and this story was it just showed how one person who saw a problem and made a decision to do something about it can actually make a difference. And there's something really hopeful and empowering about that. And that's something that I do really think that this is a movie that people can participate with, because you don't leave the theater going, oh, Bryan Stevenson was a great person. You leave the theater going, that person is doing this right now, and you can go to EJI.org and see him and his team, which is a team full of like lawyers who are veterans, but also like young lawyers who are in their early 20s, who are just out of law school, who are all extremely passionate to try to make change and support the most vulnerable people in our society. And there's something extremely hopeful about that to me.
Well, thank you very much for coming by and also to contributing to the positive idea of how the world should go, because not everybody does.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.